Hey, good morning. It is great to be with you this morning. Today we wrap up this series that we've been in, The Art of Holding Things Loosely. And I want to begin with this, and I want to say that I, now as an adult, I realize all that I took for granted as a young child. All that I took for granted as a teenager, as a middle schooler, as a high schooler, all that I took for granted that my parents did for me. Like, I didn't appreciate them. And I get it when you're a kid, like, you don't think in those terms, right? Like, let me ask you, students, do you like appreciate your parents? Or you just think that every day you get up in the morning, you say, man, my parents are so wonderful. They do so much for me. No, you don't think that, right? But when you get older, you realize, like, so much that they did. My dad, my freshman year, I loved to play basketball. My freshman year, I played on the team, and we practiced in the morning. We practiced before school. So he would get up early in the morning to make sure that I could be there for practice. I mean, he didn't have to do that, right? I mean, the only way that I could get there, the only reason that it was possible for me to be a part of that, to experience what I experienced, to be able to enjoy what I was able to enjoy, was because he gave, was because he sacrificed, was because he was willing to get up early in the morning to get me there. And I'm sure there are other people in my life. I know there are other people in my life who sacrificed and who gave of themselves so I could be where I am, where I could get to where I could get. Not that it's like gaining anything on climbing a corporate ladder, but to be where I am today, there are people that went before me that sacrificed and that gave a lot. How about you? Can you think of someone? Can you think of a person in your life that they gave, that they sacrificed, that they did something on your behalf so you could either be who you are today, or you could get to where you're at today, or you could enjoy the things that you've been able to enjoy? Like, maybe for some it was a teacher. Maybe it was a coach. Maybe it was mom or dad that you can look back to. Maybe it was a pastor. It was someone that was just, maybe it was a very close friend of yours. But they gave so that you could be where you're at today. And you can look back and point to that and say, you know what? Man, they sacrificed so much because I could get to where I am today. Well, we look in the scriptures this morning because we have this very example that we can point to in God's word. It's found in 2 Corinthians chapter 8. If you want to turn there, you can. You can grab one of the Bibles in the seat back in front of you. The words are going to be on the screen to this passage of scripture, so you can follow along there. If you've got an electronic device, we're in the New Living Translation, but it's 2 Corinthians chapter 8, the first 5 verses. It says, "Now I want you to know, dear brothers and sisters, what God in his kindness has done through the churches in Macedonia. They are being tested by many troubles, and they are very poor, but they are also filled with abundant joy, which is overflowed in rich generosity." And we need to stop right here for just a second, because there's a lot just in these first few verses, and we're not going to be able to cover it all because our time is short here this morning. But I just want to make light of this and point to this, that it's God who gets all the credit, that it's God who deserves our praise, it's God who deserves our thanks, it's God who deserves all of our worship, because it's his plan. This idea of generosity, this idea of giving for the good of others, it is God's plan. Generosity is God's plan for us and for those around you. And we need to make sure that we recognize that it is God who deserves all the credit, all the praise, all the worship for it, because it's his plan. He is the one who gives. He's our example. He's our model of the one who gives the best and the perfect gifts. And just how he gives, it's in that light that we too should be generous and should give towards one another. It's the mission that he's called us to. It's the mission that he invites us in, to be generous, to be givers of what you have been blessed with, the things that God has given us. Like it's a mission, what he's given us, that we freely give, that we don't grip things tightly as owners do, that we talked about a few weeks ago, that we hold things loosely in our hands, that we are willing to share with others because we don't own them, we're simply stewards of them. So generosity is God's plan. There are a couple other things here in these first few sentences that I find so interesting. It talks about the churches in this Macedonian area who had been tested by many troubles and that they were very poor. Now, immediately I think, well, it's because they're churches, right? They're being persecuted just because of being a church and because those coming against the kingdom of heaven. But as you read some commentaries, you realize that it was just kind of a poor area, that it wasn't necessarily just because they were churches that they were being persecuted. They were just poor people. It was an impoverished, poor area. And so they didn't have much. But here's what I find interesting. Though they didn't have much, it says they are also filled with abundant joy, which is overflowed in rich generosity. Now, I don't know about you, but generosity is a word for me that when I just say generosity or I say someone is generous, I don't feel like I have to use another word to like make emphasis on generosity. Like if someone is generous, that's an incredible compliment. Like when I mean, there are people that I can think of right now, like they are just incredibly, they're generous people, right? But when God's word says that they've overflowed with rich generosity. Man, for me, that brings a whole new depth of meaning that these people, though they were poor, though they found themselves with many troubles and just tough stuff going on, they could still give generously and they still had abundant joy. Like, I don't know about you, but typically I don't connect those words, like poor and joyful or troubles and cheerful. Typically you think, man, if people are poor or if there's a lot going on or if they're struggling with stuff, like where does that joy come from? Like, wouldn't they be upset? Wouldn't they be depressed? Wouldn't they be, you know, just aggravated and mad all the time? No, though they had troubles and though they were poor, they were joyful people and they overflowed with rich generosity. If we go on in this short passage, it says, "For I can testify that they gave not only what they could afford, but far more." It's one of the things that we think about, like when you think about giving, when you think about sharing with others, Do you sit down, you kind of take the pluses and the minuses, you take your income, you take your expenses, you pay everything you've got to pay, and then, okay, I've got this left over. Now what am I going to do with this? Like there's a certain amount you can afford. Like when you lay out a budget, right? You say, okay, this is how much for a house, this is how much for a vehicle payment, this is how much for all these other expenses. And so you lay out, you know how much you can afford. We find these people that it says they not only gave, but they gave more than they could afford. So it may not make sense on paper. It may not make sense on the budget, but they found a way to give in just this incredible way. And you ask yourself the question, why? Man, why did they? Why did they give in that fashion? Why did they give in that manner? Why did they give above and beyond? So if they gave more than they could afford, what does that mean? It means that they gave some of their resources that maybe they were going to use to feed themselves. It means they gave some of their resources that maybe they were going to use to make payment for other things. They couldn't afford it, but yet they still gave for some crazy reason, right? And they did it of their own free will. I don't think that's in there by accident. They did it by their own free will. It wasn't some smooth talking person that came in and they were able to convince them, hey, you know what? If you give a little bit of this and you give some of this, well, all this stuff's going to, no, they gave of their own free will. No, nobody was there with it wouldn't be a gun to their head, you know, maybe a slingshot or something to the head. It wasn't that, but there wasn't someone there forcing them, telling them, you know, you really need to do this. You have to. They gave of their own free will. And it goes beyond that. It's like it just keeps getting deeper and deeper. Not only did they give their own free will, but they begged us again and again for the privilege of sharing. Now, let me ask you, I'm going to go to the students again. Let me ask you this question. Have you ever found yourself at school going up to one of your friends and saying, you know what, please, will you let me give you my Skittles, right? Can I just share with you my Twix bar? Can I give you this, you know, these Sour Patch, you know, whatever those things are, those disgusting things you guys eat? Have you ever experienced that? Have you ever done it? Have you ever had another student come up to you and do that? Adults, have you ever experienced that? Have you ever had someone come up and say, I beg of you, I beg of you, let me give this to you. Let me share my resources. Let me share what I have. Let me just please, let me give it to you. Have you experienced that? I don't know if I have. But these Macedonian churches, they begged again and again for the privilege of sharing in the gift for the believers in Jerusalem. Here's what we find too. The second thing that we find in this passage is that sharing with others is a privilege. Sharing with others is a privilege. It's not a burden. It shouldn't be a burden. But I'm afraid in the times and in the culture and in the days in which we live, giving seems to be more of a burden than it is a privilege. God's word tells us that it should be a privilege. It shouldn't be about what we're losing. Oh man, if I give this, or if I give that, or if I give of my time, man, I'm going to miss out. I'm going to lose this. I'm going to not be able to get this, or to buy this, or to experience this. And it's not that what we lose. But when we share, we win. When we share, others win. You know how we win when we share? I don't know if you're, you know, if you've experienced this, but when you give to other people, when you share things with them, I think I'm blessed more than they are. Like even though it is so incredible when somebody helps you, right? Like most of you know, I can't fix things like at home. I can't, like my car, like I need help on those things. And so when there are good friends of mine that know how to change brakes and things like that. It's wonderful when someone can help me with those things, right? But I know when I'm the one that's giving, it is such a blessing. It's such a privilege. Honestly, it is an honor to be able to share with others, to give with others what God has blessed me with and what he's blessed you with. Sharing with others is a privilege. And I think the last thing that we're going to talk about here this morning in this passage is, if we finish it up, this last sentence says, they even did more than we had hoped. How many times do people show up in your life and they give above and beyond? They give more than what you even expected. I don't know. My guess is it's probably the exception as opposed to the rule. That they show up and they give even more than what you had hoped. Like quite often we think, oh man, it'd be great if it were this. And a lot of times it comes in under expectations, but not here, man. Not these Macedonian churches. They did even more than what they had hoped. For their first action was to give themselves to the Lord. That's the last thing that I want to point out here is that we need to understand that we need to give ourselves to God first and foremost. If you want to fill in the blank on your bulletin, that before we ever give a dollar, we must first give our heart. Before we ever give our resources, our finances, our stuff, our possessions, even our time, before we ever give any of that, we must first give our hearts. We must first have our heart bent and directed towards God, towards our Heavenly Father, because it's when we are in that right relationship that we get and that we understand what generosity is all about, that we understand what giving, we get that giving is a privilege, not a burden. And how do we know that? How do we understand that? Because we know it because we have a personal relationship with the God who modeled it, with the God who said, yes, I'm willing to put on flesh. I'm willing to come to this earth and to be a human being, to walk as a man, to become a servant and to die a cruel death on a cross, because I know it's the only way for salvation for us, for me. And so God modeled it. And so that's how we understand and we realize it and we know it. And so I've got a couple questions. I've got a few questions here. Because the Macedonian churches gave, what do you think happened in Jerusalem? What do you think happened to the kingdom of heaven, the kingdom of God? Because these Macedonian churches, they gave, and they gave above and beyond, and they gave with rich generosity, the kingdom advanced, right? The gospel was spread. Lives were changed. You and I are here today as a result because there were those that went before us who gave generously, who sacrificed, who gave of themselves and of their things so that those after them could benefit. And we sit here this morning as beneficiaries of that. So the Macedonian churches gave in an incredible way. What if New Hope? What if church, we could do something amazing like the Macedonian churches did? What if you know, New Hope and other churches in our community, what if we could do something like the Macedonian churches did? What if we could be a part of something bigger than what we could do on our own? Like if collectively we would gather together with others and we would give, we would possibly pool resources and give to see God's kingdom advance here in our community, here in our nation, across the globe. What if New Hope, we could be a part of sending the gospel, of sharing the good news of Jesus Christ to the ends of the earth? What if church, what if we could be a part of the kingdom advancing in areas that are hardened, in areas where it is predominantly like Muslim and Buddhist and where there's just very little of the gospel? What if church, we could be a part of something like that? I'm glad you asked.